To this very day, I cannot believe that Jack and Daxter: The Precursor Legacy for the PlayStation 2 was actually one of the earliest titles released for the PlayStation 2. I mean, it's not a launch title, but it's still pretty much released in like the first year of the PS2's life cycle. 'Cause the game is simply gorgeous, with textures that compete with PS2 games that were made like 5 years or 5 years or so later. With colorful and vibrant environments, all of which are governed by impressive day-night cycle, fluid and entertaining animations that seem to be ahead of its time, and the total absence of any load screens or any load times for that matter. This is Naughty Dog's first game for the PS2, and it was released on December 2001, but when I booted it up on my PS3, I just couldn't believe that fact. Was Naughty Dog really this talented? And my amazement never subsided as I played more of the game. Actually, I became more and more amazed the more I played the game. The level design was multi-layered, and yet transitioning from one environment to another was seamlessly executed. I expected a loading screen between the volcanic valleys and the snowy mountains, but the fact was, there was no such thing. The platforming sections were inventive, requiring me to pass through all kinds of obstacles with all of my abilities. Most of the time, I was jumping from one platform to another, but few tricky moments involved swinging around poles and dodging past explosive barrels that bounced toward me. With the sandbox design of the game, the levels also felt free and adventurous. The game's only objective was that I collect power cells to unlock more areas to explore. With such a simple objective, the game ultimately features a world with many distinct environments, from a beach filled with seagulls, to a misty forest, to a dark spider cave, to a gigantic metal structure. There are lots of things to collect, and there are lots of environments to explore, making Jak and Daxter a true platforming game. Overall, this game is incredibly fun and addicting. What makes it so awesome is that each environment in the game offers a lot of variety. Sure, you'll always be searching for seven Scott flies to earn a power cell, and you'll always be collecting precursor herbs scattered throughout the game. But aside from those consistent collectathon quests, there are towers to climb, pelicans to chase, cannons to fire, and vehicles to drive, whether that be through an 800-degree volcanic valley or around a small dock in a foggy island. Some driving sequences can admittedly be a bit tedious, and some collectibles are located much too far away from the nearest spawn point. But these are easy to forget about when considering just how much fun this game offers. Nearly everything about this game is fine-tuned for accessibility and enjoyment, right down to the convenient health system in which you will die if you get hit 3 times, but by collecting 50 green particles, you can regain back your health. There are other eco particles you can obtain in order to activate certain powers, like shooting yellow beams or activate moving platforms and launch pads. The basic mechanics all fit appropriately to the game's masterful level design. Thus, my conclusion for this game is that this is one of Naughty Dog's finest work. 8 years after its release, this game still looks great and still plays wonderfully. It may be a bit disappointing for you completionists out there. Collecting all 101 power cells earns you a really lame bonus cutscene that doesn't last more than 20 seconds. But this is a platformer that is bound to entertain anyone who comes to play it, even for those who hate collectathons because how much variety and fun it offers.